Hello, lovely internet strangers. I hope you're doing well. I will do my best to make this video semi-standalone, but this is technically part two following my previous Anti-Feminist Diaries video about my female friend who did not drop me for leaving feminism or changing my political beliefs. So this video is best watched after part one, which is linked in the description. So I have a lot of thoughts about dating in the modern era, especially in the city, especially when you're a feminist, and all the problems that it brings, and how women should act, what they should do. And it all comes back to my belief in personal responsibility, which the modern feminist movement is lacking, very badly lacking. It's really amazing how the feminist movement preaches female empowerment and how women are just as strong as men and just as good as men at everything. And yet the insecurity of modern women who claim to be feminists at the end of the day, they may say one thing, but the way they act reveals something entirely different. So I'm sure I will make several videos on this topic during my time on this channel, but today I wanted to talk about it using the friend I discussed in my previous video as a lens, as an archetype almost of a certain kind of woman, share some of her stories, the issues that come up, some of the ways that I have attempted to engage her to lead to a better outcome for her dating life. And if you did not watch my previous video, the reason I switched to engaging her through dating stories rather than regular conversations about other topics is because she's a bit too high on trait agreeableness. Those conversations just weren't fun for either of us. And I figured at the end of the day, what good is my anti-feminism if it doesn't change real women's lives? So this friend was in a several years long relationship with a guy she met in college, and it was long distance. When we met, she had been in this relationship for a few years already. From my perspective, he treated her terribly, but at the end of the day, she let him treat her that way. When she finally ended that relationship, she was single in New York City, and the last time she was single, dating apps were not a big thing. So she was feeling a bit lost, but she started meeting guys from dating apps, and she would tell me stories. And I would try, and still try, to inject my anti-feminist perspective without saying specifically, I'm gonna be an anti-feminist here, or I think your feminism is fucking up your dating life. One example is when she told me about a guy who messaged her and clearly just wanted to hook up. He basically said, hey, come over. And she said no, but she still agreed to meet up with him, not at his apartment, to see how they got along. And he suggested, of course, a place that was near his apartment, but he did not tell her that this was the case. And she said the conversation wasn't really flowing, and then he asked if she wanted to go somewhere else, but didn't specify a place. Which makes me think of a quote from Jack Donaghy on 30 Rock when he said, never go with a hippie to a second location. Like, just never agree to go to a second location if you don't know where it is. But she said yes, and they went back to his place. And she told me the story over chat, so I don't know the logistics. Like, when she realized she was being led to an apartment building, did she say, hey man, I don't want to go to your apartment? I don't know. So when they got to his place, he was immediately in her personal space and touching her. And she said basically that if they had chilled in the living room for a bit and were like watching a movie, and then during the movie, he had tried to like get all up in her personal space, she might have had a different reaction. But he just went from 0 to 60. And she said that he didn't even buy her tea when they were at the coffee shop. And I said, must be a feminist. He believes in women's economic equality. And she said, I mean, I don't mind paying for my own stuff, but like, if you want to fast forward to happy fun times, you gotta help grease the wheels. There was no courtship or wooing. It was really ugh. And I said, what I'm hearing is, to get in my pants, you at least have to buy me some tea. And she said, minimum level of investment. And in my head, I thought, okay, so for you, sex is transactional. That's interesting, because I certainly don't share that view. But maybe I'm the odd one. Subsequent to that conversation about the guy who did not buy her tea, she chatted me about another guy on OkCupid who messaged her with a ridiculous line and was clearly just trying to get in her pants. It was a weird line, and I don't remember exactly what it was, but she said something like, oh, does he think this kind of line works? And I said something like, well, you know, sometimes you message a chick making it clear you just want to hook up, and then later she agrees to go out with you anyway, even though she doesn't want to just hook up. So sometimes it does work. And she said something like, fair point. So, you know, I felt pretty victorious in that moment. A point for anti-feminism, or more like a point for reality. This friend is a classic example of that woman who's in her early 30s, working a white-collar job, living the city life, but doesn't have a life partner yet, but still says she wants to find that life partner and that she wants to have kids. But the clock is ticking. First, she has to find a life partner, and even then, that partner would probably want to wait a bit. I told her in the past that she should get serious and list the exact qualities she wants in a partner. Most importantly, her deal breakers, and then to filter dates based on that criteria. But as far as I can tell, she did not do that. She usually dates two categories of guys. The first category are guys she gets along with okay, but ultimately there's something about them that makes her view them as not long-term life partner material. But she continues to date them because it's nice to have companionship. And I respect that, as long as you're both on the same page about it. Then the other category are guys that she's really excited about, but he turns out to be emotionally unavailable or just not emotionally available for her. So one time she's telling me about this guy who had resurfaced in her life. When they had dated, she had gotten really excited about him. Then she waited too long to ask him to be exclusive because she was afraid of rocking the boat. And when she did talk about it, he told her he was getting back together with his ex, with whom he'd had a horrendous breakup. But this time they were going to have an open relationship. And as someone who has lived a non-monogamous life, I was like, oh honey, you couldn't pass relationship skills 101, but you want to upgrade to a relationship model that requires relationship skills 401? Good plan. So that just told me that this guy was an idiot, and I was like, good riddance. But when that inevitably imploded, this guy came sniffing back around wanting to hook up with my friend again, and she was considering his offer. He was like, well, I'm not ready for a commitment right now or available for that, but let's hook up. And she was telling me about the situation, basically saying that she really liked him and hoped to someday be his girlfriend, and that he couldn't choose her unless she made herself essentially available and in his orbit, you know, his hookup orbit. And when I was younger, I used to offer a lot more, shall we say, judgmental advice, whether solicited or not. But I learned over time that women don't usually appreciate that. And so I got to a place where I would just listen, particularly with this friend, because it's not like she ever takes my advice, really. So we were just walking along, and I hadn't said anything after she had told me this story. Eventually she said, I would really like your opinion. And I said, okay, how honest do you want me to be? Like, do you want me to be really honest? And she said, yeah. And I still dialed it in for her a little bit, you know. If I was being brutally honest, it would have been a lot harsher. So I said, pretend that I'm telling you that this guy I went out with before, who I was really into and who fucked off to be with an ex, is now sniffing back around just wanting to hook up. And even though I really want to be his girlfriend, I'm basically going to hang around hoping that someday after hooking up with him for a while, when he's ready, he'll choose me to be his girlfriend. Would you be excited for me? What do you think you would say to me? I know 100% that you would not be saying, go for it, that sounds great. You'd be saying, you shouldn't be anyone's second choice. You should not be wasting your time that way. You should have self-respect. And you know, she heard me. And she did not, as far as I remember, go hook up with this guy. So, you know, she's a feminist and she's all about how women are tough and women are strong and women are awesome. But there are a lot of times that she sure as hell does not act like it. And I know people aren't perfect and that people need to grow. But I expect this from someone who's in their early 20s, who has much less idea of their own worth and their own value. But possibly if you don't have a certain amount of dating experience, and she essentially spent most of her prime dating years in an unhealthy long-term relationship, then maybe it's harder to come by that knowledge of your own worth and value, because I know I developed that knowledge through experience. Another issue this friend has that is common among women dating today is that she doesn't establish her boundaries. She lets men walk over her boundaries that they don't know exist because she hasn't mentioned them, but she still becomes resentful, which comes out in conversations with me. But the reason she's resentful is entirely under her control. Guys who follow the red pill philosophy talk about how guys need to have control over frame, where frame is an unspoken acceptance of one person's authority that the other person is going to follow. And it is true that in most heterosexual relationships, the man will try to control frame. And in my opinion, in response to that, women need to set and enforce boundaries. They need to establish how they will conduct themselves in a relationship and what their expectations are regarding their partner's behavior. And they need to stick to it, which means speaking up and being willing to walk away if necessary. The concept of establishing and enforcing boundaries applies if you're a lesbian or a bisexual woman, and it applies for non-romantic relationships as well, but is especially important for women engaged in heterosexual dating relationships to establish if they are, for example, the kind of woman who's willing to have sex on the first date. And if they say they're not, to stand firm and not change their mind later on because they allowed themselves to be manipulated. Public service announcement. The way to get a man to respect you is not by fucking him. If you don't demonstrate any boundaries or stick to the ones that you set, you're signaling to a man that you can be manipulated and he will try again to step over your boundaries. And if you don't communicate your boundaries, even guys with good intentions will walk over your boundaries because they don't know they're there. And if you don't enforce your boundaries, no one else will. So if you tell a guy, when you say you're going to call me, I need you to call me, and then he continually does not meet that request and you just let it go, not only are you going to be resentful, but he's never going to change his behavior because you're letting him get away with it. You lose your negotiating power the minute that you are not willing to walk away. And I've definitely seen that over and over again in my conversations with this friend about her dating relationships. She'll be afraid to talk to a guy she's dating about being exclusive. And I'll tell her, if you like them and you want to be exclusive with them and you'll be unhappy not being exclusive with them, then have the conversation sooner rather than later. Maybe the answer is they're not ready to be exclusive right now. And you can decide how long you're going to wait and then revisit the conversation. But if they say, no, I don't want to be exclusive with you ever, better to know that now. But you need to be willing to walk away when they say that because it is not what you want. And as I said, she's a feminist, but there is a complete lack of this kind of messaging in the modern feminist movement. Modern feminists tend to blame the guy and say things like, he treated you badly, he's a fuckboy, he did this, he did that. There's no mirror being held up to show women the ways their own behavior contributes to the outcomes in their dating life and how they can change that behavior to find happiness. Women are stripped of their agency, but the reality is that women have a lot of agency when dating. They just have to be willing to exercise it. Feminism also teaches modern women that they don't have to do anything really to get a man. The man should be hot and educated and of their social class or above and interesting and talk about his emotions and be passionate and the whole package. But she doesn't have to go to the gym or have interesting hobbies or be emotionally stable or work on herself or take personal responsibility for her actions. To be fair, what most men want is just a woman who meets their minimum standards for attractiveness, who is nice, and not a complete idiot, who they can talk to about some of their interests. That's pretty much it. I don't mean you can't be like sarcastic and kind of a bitch sometimes, but in a fun way, not like a nagging way or a crazy way. Oh, I'm sorry, we can't call women crazy. That's just a thing that men call women when they're being reasonable and asserting their boundaries. Please. If you're asserting your boundaries and then you're willing to walk away, and I do not see that happening with the majority of women today, particularly in my age group. I'm not saying that women don't break up with men anymore. They definitely do. But it's generally after their boundaries have been so trampled over that they snap and the act is done out of resentment. And then they tell their girlfriends that he's a fuckboy when what really happened is they never told him where the line was. Now, believe me, I have not always walked the walk, especially when I was younger. The example of the guy not calling when he says he's going to was brought to you courtesy of my first high school boyfriend. Maybe I will expand on some of those stories in future videos, and maybe I have high standards or unreasonable expectations for women, but by the time they're in their 30s, I expect them to be women and not girls. And if you're in a relationship and consistently not asserting your boundaries, I'm not going to call you a woman. You're a girl. But I'll give you one story from my mid-20s that illustrates how to assert boundaries without resentment. I was dating this guy who was married. Ethically, his wife knew, and so did my husband. I know there are a bunch of people out there who hate non-monogamy. Hello, you're welcome here too. I realized early on that he was already seeing someone who filled a girlfriend kind of role, and I was more in the role of hot chick who I can drink beer with and talk about books kind of a role. I met his wife, but it was only by happenstance. I realized that he had no intentions of bringing me any further into his life, and I made my peace with that. But it did have me considering whether it was worth my time to continue that relationship. But the thing that really stepped over my boundary was that he would be incredibly flaky about plans. We didn't have much time together because we both had primary relationships, and I understood that, but he would cancel at the last minute and not be transparent about circumstances in his life that led him to canceling. I would have completely understood if he had just said to me, hey, my wife is going through some things. I can make plans with you, but I may have to cancel at the last minute. So, you know, bear with me. I'm not doing it to be a dick. But he didn't say any of that. He was just consistently flaky until I confronted him about it. And then he came out with the explanation. But by that point, I had asked myself, okay, I'm dating this guy and I'm putting up with this behavior. Would I tolerate this behavior from a friend? And the answer was no. And so I broke things off with him. I said something like, I like you. I have fun with you. It's clear you're not bringing me any further into your life, and I can accept that. But you can't communicate to me about what's going on in your life when it affects our time together. And you're not respecting my time, and you're not respecting me. And if you can't change that, it's better if we part ways. I waited maybe a bit longer than I could have to have the conversation, but I didn't bring resentment. I wasn't devastated emotionally, and I didn't have a story afterward about what a fuckboy he was. He said he couldn't disagree with anything I'd said, and we don't talk anymore, but we parted without any animosity. So I give that as an example to show that it can be done. It's not rocket science. It's not fun, but in the long run, I think it's better to be in relationships with people who are not stepping over your boundaries. I think it's better to be in relationships where you can tell people when they step over your boundaries. Of course, you have to actually know what your boundaries are in the first place, which I don't think most women spend a lot of time thinking about. In this example, I knew that someone disrespecting my time by continually canceling at the last minute was a deal breaker, whether in a lover or a friend. So if there are any women watching that need some advice on this topic, here are my two cents. Anytime you feel any kind of resentment in a relationship, whether it is a romantic relationship or a friendship, because God knows female friendships can be prone to a ton of resentment, ask yourself why. Ask yourself what it is they are doing that is causing you to feel resentful. And ask yourself if you have told them about this behavior. If you have not, then your course of action is to enlighten them. If you have already told them about the behavior, that means you're letting them get away with it. And you need to have a conversation where you assert that boundary. And depending on the circumstance, you either have to be willing to walk away if it's a deal breaker, or be willing to, if you're in a very committed relationship, reframe how you see that particular issue to come to an understanding with that person about that particular issue. But the resentment is always under your control. Do not let your insecurities or your fear of conflict stop you from having conversations that you need to have. So I still really care about this friend, but I do feel less close to her than I used to. It's nice to have a female friend that I can talk to about girly stuff and relationship stories, but we have very different core values and worldviews and very different approaches to life. Because it's not just that my friend is a feminist or a leftist, it's this lack of exercising personal responsibility to work toward the life she wants. And I'm not perfect, and I have mental health struggles that get in the way sometimes, but I do have goals for myself that I am working toward. Sometimes I get stuck, but I make incremental progress. But she's basically where I used to be, just talking about things and how she'd like them to be different, but nothing changes. Whereas at this point in my life, my other close friends have visions for their lives, and they're taking action toward realizing those visions. So I love her, but it would be nice to find at least one woman I could actually be close to. I did meet a woman recently through one of my close male friends, and she lives far away, and I can't talk to her about feminism and politics, but she and I are similar in our personalities and our general outlook on life. So that's nice. But I am still on the hunt for the women I can talk to about feminism and politics. There is one viewer of this channel who wrote me a very nice email. She knows who she is. And we've interacted a little bit over the internet, and that's really, really nice. And that may be the only place that I can find these women, because we seem to be scattered across the world. There does not seem to be any great volume of us anywhere. So locally, I may be stuck with the men. But you know what? I am masculine of center. I relate to the men, and I will probably make a whole other video on that in a future Anti-Feminist Diaries episode. But for now, this is where I leave you. Thank you for watching. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them below or email me. I appreciate hearing from you. If you liked this video, please give it a like. If you'd like to see more, please subscribe, and I hope to have more content for you very soon.